telling him that. He said, the easiest example is me and my family here. I said, how? He said, look at me. I'm one man, right?
Yes.
My wife is one person. Yes?
Yes.
And my son, a little boy in a stroller. It's one.
Yeah?
One, one, one. One family, three people. It's the family of God. Works. Let's try that one. We need to get ready for all of that one. What happens if they have another kid? Twins, clown. What if they get a divorce? Ooh. I don't know how it is in Australia, but in Texas, if you get a divorce, the wife gets the car, the house, the bank account, the Keio plan, your retirement program, any benefits, your computer, and all of your email. Now, I don't want a God that can have worm in it. I don't want a God that can be rotten. And I sure don't want a God that can die, because people can die. So now I'm asking the Muslim, finally, I ask him. He didn't offer anything unless I asked him. He didn't push. What do you guys say about God? Is he one or three or two or how? What do you guys say? And listen to what he said. Bismillah. Allahu samad. Lam yalid wa lam yulad. The translation, say, O Muhammad, we're asking you about God, say he is Allah, the unique, the eternally sought after by all creation for sustenance, yet he is not sustained. As Samad. Samad is big, big name. Lam Yalid, the Lam Yalid. He's not the father of anything. He's not the son of anybody. He has no genealogy. The Lam Yakun, who is the one ahead, and he doesn't compare to anything, anywhere, anytime, because he's so unique. Oh. Well, what's he like? Laysa kamithlihi shay'in wa huwa samiun basir. He's not like anything in his creation. Yet he is all-hearing, all-seeing. He's all-knowledgeable. He's all-merciful. He's all-loving. Al-Wadud. He's all-praiseworthy. And he is the peace. As-Salam. And he is the light on you. And he's the only one that you can turn to and ask for any help. And when I'm hearing these words, I'm thinking, that's what I already believe. That's in the Bible. I saw that in the book, this book, that book. I remember the New Testament said this and this. This is the God, man. How did we come up with three? Catholic priest provided that answer for us. Oh yeah, he was very knowledgeable in the history of the church. I got it on my website, just in case you want to check it out. IslamTomorrow.com/Bible. I didn't put my commercial in the middle, so when they try to edit it out, they can't, you know. IslamTomorrow.com/Bible. I took it from the Catholic website so you can see it for yourself. They say that the church started in the year 325 A.D. after Jesus, hello? And that's when they held the council to establish God to be three and one at the same time. That's also when they decided how many books need to be in the Bible and how many don't need to be. They also decided to change Jesus' birthday to be December 25th for some other God they already had in Rome. They also added Easter, the Feast of Ishtar, all of that at the same time. Now I'm hearing this coming from the Catholic right there telling me that's how it happened. I happen to know a little bit about the Protestant religion. It's a break off from the Catholic.
And then when the Protestants broke off from the Catholic, they crossed out seven books of the Bible. That's why there's 73 in the Catholic and 66 in the Protestant Bible. Comparing book to book, gods to gods, it just was mathematically a lot easier for me. But that's not why I went to Islam. I'd like to tell you that it was because of all the rationality behind it, but it wasn't. It was something else. It's because when I thought about it, I realized that there's something inside of me that likes to do what I want to do, regardless of what anybody else says. But there's also a side in me that knows that this is wrong. I need to do what he wants me to do. And now I'm in a fight inside of myself between submitting to him, as we already mentioned that means Islam, or doing what I want to do. Guess what? While all of this was going on, I'm not the only person in this story. I'm the only one telling it today, but the real people of this story don't get out and tell all about it. So I'm telling their story for them. It was the priest who had the biggest job of all, not me. Because he was dedicated to his religion for so many years. He had been a missionary going out to South America, Central America, Mexico, learning their languages and speaking their dialect. Yet he was from New York. He was an Irish priest from New York. He gave up everything to be a priest. He can't get married. He can't have any children, of course. No grandchildren, no intimate relationship. He gave it all up for the Lord. That's an important concession for a person to do. We don't want to make fun of that. This man has given up more than any of us would really think about doing for our way. Alhamdulillah, Allah didn't ask us to do that. But this man asked our friend, because now we're calling him a friend. He's no longer an infidel Muslim anymore. Our Egyptian friend. He said, can I go to your church? Can I go out there to you, wherever you worship? He said, sure. Took him to the masjid during the week. They came back that night. He said, what happened? He said, what do you mean? He said, come here. What did they do? They like slaughter animals or something? He said, no. He said, they stand the same way that monks stand in a monastery, like this, silently worshiping God. But then they do something that only the priest gets to do, which is a sajda. They bow and do sajda, but he just mentioned the sajda. He said, it's so peaceful, there's no sound. It's so sweet. I said, what? That's not the kind of religion I grew up in, right? I said, okay, what kind of music did they play? He said, there wasn't any music. I said, what? How are you going to worship God without music? He said, they didn't have any instruments. So I went to my friend, the Egyptian. I said, is that true? You guys don't have any music in your worship service? He said, no. No organs? Uh-uh. No pianos? Uh-uh. Now we were in that business, Estes Organ and Piano Company, that's us. How many mosques are there on the earth today? He said, millions. I said, do you think the Muslims would like to start music in their services? I see opportunity here. He said, I don't think so. And then, a few days later, the priest asked if he could go again to the mosque. Because the Muslim regularly would go. He would say, I need to go visit the mosque. Even though they drove something like 25 miles, they would go and come back. That night, they didn't come back, and we were scared. We thought something happened to them. It got later and later and later and later. They missed supper, everything. Finally, they come up the driveway. We could see them coming in the driveway. Saw them get out of the car. Started to come up to the porch. And I looked out. Right away, I recognized the shiny spot on the Egyptian. He didn't have any hair. But who is this with him? Who is this guy I see standing with him? Who's wearing a white dress and got one of these things on his head. And I looked, I said, that's Father Peter Jacobs. I said, Pete, did you become a Muslim? He said, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. I was shocked. How could this be a priest became a Muslim? I went and got my camera. We used to have a TV show, Estes Music Jamboree. Got the cameras out. I was going to do an interview with him right then and there. Why did the priest become a Muslim? By the time I got everything hooked up, got the lights all turned on, he fell asleep. So I went upstairs. It's still running through my head. It must be after midnight. I'm upstairs talking to my wife. I'm saying, my God, what's going on? A priest becomes a Muslim? What is this? Is this amazing? Look, they one God, they got the Quran, so and so. And she said, all of a sudden, I want a divorce. Huh? She said, I want to get a divorce. Okay. What happened? She said, all this talk about Muslim, Islam, everything, you know, doesn't work. I said, okay, we're going to have to talk about this. She said, no, we do need to talk about it. I want to get a divorce because, you see, I can see what's going on here, and I'm going to tell you, I remember what he said, talking about Muhammad, the Egyptian. He said, a Muslim can't be married to a Christian. I said, whoa, 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 whoa. Did I say I want to be a Muslim? I didn't say that. I did not say I wanted to be a Muslim. I'm talking about a priest. Sorry, drop the subject, forget the whole thing. She said, no, I want a divorce. I said, whoa. She said, because I want to be a Muslim. Huh? Been married for 7.5 years, with a couple of kids here, and I'm thinking, no, I don't want to go through that. I don't want to lose anything, including my email. I didn't have email back then. Anyhow, well, I thought about it, I said, okay, think. Okay, the good news is, I'll do it. I knew I needed to do it anyway. Let me just get it over with. I too want to become a Muslim. She said, I don't believe you. I said, no, I'm serious. I do. I really do. I didn't know how to say it before, but hey, I want to be a Muslim. She said, no, I want a divorce and you're a liar. I said, no. How do you say that? She said, either you're lying right now or you were lying 5 minutes ago when you said you didn't want to be a Muslim. Make up your mind and get out. So I was walking down the steps and I started thinking, where am I going? This is my father's house. I just got through it. Wait a minute. Now it's really late, but I went and I woke up the Egyptian and I said, I'll talk to you. He said, what's the matter? I said, step outside. We step outside. I said, a lot of stuff is happening in my life and I need to talk to you. And I began to explain and tell him everything, what's going on in my head, things happening in my whole life. Just like, you know, I've got to tell somebody. I've probably made him crazy, but you know what? The best kind of friend isn't the one that really tries to understand you. He's the one that stands beside you no matter what happens. Have you lived that?